Hi everyone, I'm Arabdha, and thank you for joining us in on this Halborn AMA. Today we are talking about Debt DAO. And from Debt DAO, we have got Chris Walker joining us in to tell us a little bit more about the company, his background, and more projects in progress with Debt DAO. So from an initial glance, Chris, what I found is that Debt DAO is creating a decentralized permissionless marketplace to buy, sell, underwrite, and manage debt in DeFi. So you kind of like tackle all elements of the debt funding ecosystem around DeFi, but do tell us a little bit more and also tell us a bit more on your profile background, what you do with Debt DAO.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I can just start from the top. I guess myself and my co-founder, what our backgrounds are. I'm the non-technical co-founder and he's the technical founder. Myself, I come from like a traditional financial background. So I used to work at JP Morgan. I focused on covering really real estate finance and mortgage originators. So I would help them identify assets that were cheaply priced, such as loans, and help them line up financing so they could purchase those on leverage and get it through the securitization process so they could effectively enhance the returns. It was like a really fun experience. I learned a lot. Like I enjoyed being in the capital markets, but I always had this itch to build something, to do something more entrepreneurial. And I saw like crypto as kind of that perfect avenue. So in early 2020, I first invested into Ethereum and did kind of your standard, you know, yield farming that happened in 2020 and in 2021. Kind of towards the end of 2021, I started venturing into, you know, hey, I want to build. Like I quit my job to kind of build something. And I thought with my expertise in credit that, you know, building something, a crypto native credit project would be the best avenue for me. So I started doing diligence, actually came about Debt DAO by joining one of their community calls where I met my co-founder, Kiba, who's not on this call, but Kiba is the technical person. So he has 5 years of experience. He used to work at Consensus doing, you know, website and app development, taught himself Solidity and kind of began messing around with smart contracts, you know, around the DeFi summer kind of time period. Contributed some DAOs, both of us. You know, I've contributed in the past to Ondo Finance. Kiba has contributed to, you know, Index Co-op, Cream Metafactory, a lot of different DAOs. And that's kind of where the genesis of the idea of Debt DAO came about is he was contributing to Index and noticed that like they were spending a lot of money paying contributors in their native token. And this is, you know, a problem that a lot of DAOs have is their DAO treasuries are like highly concentrated in their native stable, or excuse me, their native token. And if it's not their native token, it's more than likely that they have Ethereum exposure, right? So they still have price risk and they have what I call an asset liability mismatch. So their liability is they have five developers that they have on a contract and they owe them say $100,000 in the next month between the five of them, whatever it might be. The assets that they were planning to use, whether it be their native token or Ethereum, the prices fluctuate, right? So there's a mismatch between that. And it's difficult from like a financial perspective to manage your risk and financial plan for the future when you have this exposure, this unhedged exposure. So we thought, okay, if that's the case, why is there not a solution that brings stablecoin funding to DAOs? You know, everybody in the space at the time is kind of focused on taking DeFi capital and sending it to the real world. Whereas what we kind of need is you know, financial services for DAOs. Debt products is significantly cheaper than selling your tokens on the open market or selling your tokens in an OTC deal, right? That has a discount to spot market. So that was kind of the genesis of the idea. And yeah, to your point, like what we're building at Debt DAO is, you know, our first product is the line of credit and we're really excited about that. But more broadly, we want to be the one-stop shop for DAOs and have this DAO-to-DAO service model where anybody can plug into our ecosystem and provide value, whether you're a lender, a borrower, a data and analytics service provider. There's a lot that could be done here. And we're just excited to roll out our first product, which obviously is why we're partnering with you guys for the audit.
So you guys just raised a 3.6 million seed round. Very much congratulations on that. That's big news. And I kind of wanted to ask you, what does that mean for your own growth trajectory as a company?
Yeah, no, it's super exciting. And we feel, you know, grateful that we actually got to have cash, you know, in our treasury, despite the market conditions. What it means is, you know, it's a very opportune time for us to grow and expand our team. You know, as I mentioned earlier, we're auditing our first product, which is the line of credit and the Spigot smart contract. So in addition to being this one-stop shop, our first product is kind of what we call the pipe for crypto. So what we'll do is we'll offer revenue-based financing to crypto native entities such as DAOs and protocols. And we're able to do this through our Spigot smart contract, which secures borrowers' on-chain cash flows to automatically repay lenders. And this is really important because a lot of DAOs have purely on-chain revenue sources. So the Spigot is able to siphon off a predetermined percentage of those cash flows and split that between their own treasury and the lender that they agreed to take financing from. In the event of certain trigger events, we're able to escrow 100% to ensure that the lender has trustless protections, that the revenue that the borrower generates must be used to repay them as a lender. And this financing, right, helps us expand our product offering. So that's just our first product. And what we'll be looking to do is hire, you know, multiple engineers from Solidity developers to a front-end engineer to even full stack, and roll out a few more products that abstract away some of the complexities. So right now it's a peer-to-peer model, whereas opposed to a lot of the offerings currently in the market have a pooling element to them. So like an ERC 4626 pool, right, that aggregates capital and deploys it to a borrower. We'll be working on an abstraction layer that gets built on top of our base layer here, the peer-to-peer line of credit, that allows for different risk profiles of different lenders to be bucketed into certain pools. And then each of those pools then acts as one of the peers within our network. So that's an example of kind of the growth that we're looking to build on top of this project. And we've got a lot of other ideas with integrations such as, you know, yield aggregators, hedging out the risk as lenders. So like Volt's protocol allows for interest rate swaps. Lenders and borrowers could hedge their exposure to rates through an integration with them. And then potentially even, right, secondary marketplaces as they get built out. You know, Goldfinch is a great project right now. They're building out a system that allows their lenders to get in and out of positions without having to wait until maturity for the underlying loan. And we also are looking for integrations like that. So what we'll do is we'll take the financing, scale our team up, and roll out a few, you know, new products that kind of fit that bill of the one-stop shop for DAO financing.
All the business innovation around the Spigot smart contract definitely sounds very exciting. And all of those plans in general sound great to me. I know that at Halborn, we are auditing the line of credit smart contract, the Spigot smart contract, escrow, secure loan smart contract, and a couple of more things with you guys. And I wanted to ask you, what was your security strategy overall? And what was the thought process behind when you got an external auditor, us, on board?
Yeah, so I mean, security is paramount. You know, with any financial technology, it's fundamentally important that security comes first in mind. So top to bottom, we thought about security. I would say that we looked at it in a couple of different ways. So bring it back to like the peer-to-peer nature of our mm-hmm. smart contracts. So this creates an environment in which the risk becomes isolated to that specific borrower's line of credit. And only lenders that have credit exposure, right, to that borrower have risk in that. So that's number one. I would say number two, and probably more important, would be access control. And what I mean by that is both lenders and borrowers have to agree 2 of 2 before a line of credit gets deployed. And then there's certain functions within that line of credit smart contract that can be called. So outside the lender and the borrower, there's only 2 stakeholders that even have the ability to call functions. Number one would be like the Oracle. And for that, we went with kind of the DeFi standard, which is Chainlink. So we're using their price feed. So the feed registry, any asset that gets listed on Chainlink feed registry is able to be, you know, supported in our smart contracts. So from the Oracle standpoint, we figured we need to use a battle-tested project like Chainlink. And the other stakeholder would be the Arbiter. So the Arbiter can call a few different functions. It's definitely a privileged role. But really, the whole point of the arbiter is to ensure that a borrower is not able to, you know, do any kind of griefing that would hurt the lender. And we accomplish that through certain functions. So the liquidate function, the claim and repay function, those are roles in which the arbiter has the ability to call those. And only in certain times. So we have the health status of our line of credit that gets updated based on certain metrics. So for example, if the collateral ratio were to fall below a predetermined level, the arbiter then would have the ability, right, to notify the borrower to top up collateral. If that does not happen, we have the ability to execute an OTC swap, right, to make the lender whole. In cases where the spigot is attached and revenue is falling short at the end of the facility, what we then have the ability to do is do call the claim and repay and ensure that the tokens that we're swapping actually have value behind them, ensure that this is going to the lender, you know, in the manner and borrower doesn't like spoof them effectively.
What do you think is the most unaddressed security risk you see in your space today? And do you have a piece of advice around handling that?
Yeah, so I think the biggest security risk when we look at what we're building in crypto credit would be, for example, that, you know, the Spigot has the ability to attach to a borrower's revenue generating smart contract. Okay. And should said borrower, right, not repay the lender at the end of the term, there's the ability for the Spigot to remain attached to the borrower's smart contract. Now, what that effectively allows is if the Spigot were ever to be hacked, you know, there's something that needs to be addressed there, because that's like a big attack vector where if they come in, now you potentially have somebody who owns a smart contract who doesn't understand how to operate it, who could drain the funds, who could effectively make a protocol useless. So, you know, what we need to do is standardize approaches and look for where they can access and kind of control who has access to certain functions within the Spigot. But it's definitely a space that will evolve and I think needs to become more standardized.
Right, that was very interesting. Thank you so much, Chris, for joining us in on this conversation. It has been very, very informative, at least for me. And stay tuned.